evening, everyone. Happy Monday. So glad you can join us for another masterclass. I'm going to jump right in. And tonight I want to talk about an amazing benefit of the atonement, which is our salvation. And actually one step further, the assurance of our salvation as a Christian. It's so important for us to know that, in fact, we can have security with Jesus in eternal salvation and reconciliation to the Father through Jesus, his Son. But throughout history, this has actually been one of the most debated topics as to how we can have that assurance. And many people have, at some point in their Christian walk, had a struggle to really know if they're truly saved or not, if they're truly secure in their relationship with Christ or not. So it begs the question, how do you really know if you're saved? First of all, salvation, having Jesus in your heart, is not something that happens by chance. There's no auto-save button that can make you just automatically have salvation with Christ. There's no such thing as being saved by association or even the thought of being a grandchild to someone else who has faith in Christ. There's no grandchildren in God's kingdom. We're all sons and daughters of God. We're his children, not his grandchildren. So it has to be a direct relationship with him. See, the Bible actually talks also about the fruit of repentance being evident in our lives. We talked about that a few weeks ago. Something like an experience at water baptism can sometimes be an incredible moment for people to get that assurance deep in their heart. The Bible also talks about many promises of that assurance of salvation. We also see it through the role of the fruit and the fruit of the Holy Spirit in our lives and the fact that he's present, the fact that he's working in us and through us. And of course, the biggest assurance of all we find in God's word, that he confirms those things through maybe a Bible verse or even through peace in our hearts. And we see that the Bible actually promises that if someone repents and believes in Christ, they can be sure of their salvation. Romans 10:9 says that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Notice that it's not just about confession with your mouth, but it's actually also about believing in your heart. And if you believe something in your heart, it actually affects the way that you live. So salvation is not by word only. It's not just about a confession or saying words, but it's about truly believing in your heart that Jesus Christ is Lord, that he was risen from the dead for you, that he died and rose again for you. Because if we truly grab a hold of that, we will live different lives. So why is it then that so many people struggle with this concept or even experience condemnation from the enemy regarding this that would make them unsure of their position with Christ? And there are many differing views, even in the Christian world, of what security actually means. So first of all, I want to just define the word assurance. When we talk about assurance of salvation, it means the inner knowledge that God has forgiven and accepted us in Christ. That's what assurance of salvation is. See, assurance comes first and foremost from the Word of God. That is the biggest source that we have, our foundation that we can stand on. It's actually the only firm foundation that we can base anything to do with our faith on. See, the truth of God's Word supersedes how we feel. See, the enemy will try to tell us that if we make a mistake, we're no longer okay with God. But the Word of God tells us that if we sin or if we make a mistake, we actually have an advocate that is fighting on our behalf. In 1 John 2, verse 1 and 2, it says, "My dear children, I write this so that you will not sin." See, the Word of God says that his desire for us is to not sin. But then it goes on and it says, "But if anybody does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for ours, but also for the sins of the whole world." See, right there, we have such an amazing assurance through the Word of God that says that, hey, his desire is for us to not sin, but if we do, we have an advocate in Jesus, and he is the one that will reconcile us forever with Christ if we follow him and if we obey him. So the second part that gives us that assurance is the witness of the Holy Spirit. Romans 8 verse 16 actually says the Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. See, the Holy Spirit can give you an assurance that nothing else can give you because he bears witness inside of us. This is what Paul talks about in this verse, that the Spirit of God witnesses with our spirit. It confirms that we are indeed a child of God. See, there's a big difference between the Holy Spirit solidifying something in our hearts rather than our own emotions trying to convince ourselves of something else. Big difference. So we need to rely on the power of God and the Holy Spirit that he has provided for us. The third thing that can affirm that assurance is a clear conscience. See, this is when you know that you are right with God. God wants us to have a clear conscience because he knows that it'll give us the confidence and the assurance of our standing and our relationship with him. 1 Timothy 1:5 says, "Now the purpose of the commandment is love from a pure heart and from a good conscience and from sincere faith." See, the whole purpose is that if we live in the love of Christ, we can have that good conscience and sincere faith that that verse is talking about. And see, the best way to have a clear conscience, according to the Bible, is repentance, which is why we talked about that a couple of weeks ago, because God does not want us to live in fear, but at peace. And sometimes that simply means that when we mess up, we repent, we turn to God. Remember, repenting means turning away from something. And then we can come to God with a clear conscience. Actually, Romans does talk about the fear of authority. Now, they use natural authority as the example there, because they say that, you know, if you fear authority, it's often because you've done something wrong. So you live in fear of that. But if we truly understand our identity in Christ as our ultimate authority, we understand that if we're secure in our relationship with him, if we're walking in obedience with him, then we don't have to fear him because he wants us to live in peace, not in fear. And the fourth thing where we can see that assurance is, of course, through the testimony of a Christian life. See, the fact is that when you're a Christian and when you walk with Jesus, your life will keep changing over and over. And that's the assurance that you're indeed walking with God, allowing the word of God to change you and to transform you to be more like him. See, there's a desire when we truly know him to please him and walk in a way that reflects his nature. Remember that we're called to bear God's image and reflect his nature. Matthew 12:33 says, "Either make a tree good and its fruit good, or else make a tree bad and its fruit bad, because a tree is known by its fruit." See, if you have a sincere Christian life and relationship with Christ, if you're connected to the vine, then you'll see fruit that comes from that. So I want to talk briefly about a couple of words in regards to this whole topic, and that's the word perseverance and security. So this is speaking about the issue of potentially losing your salvation, because the Bible tells us we can be secure in it, but there's also something called the potential of losing it. So how secure is your salvation? So if you're thinking, what is the least I can do, and what's the least I can get away with and still be a Christian? I would say that you're asking yourself the wrong question. Because to have assurance of your relationship with Christ and your salvation in Christ, you understand that the goal is to become more and more like him, and not to edge your way closer and closer to the line of sin. But instead, the Bible actually talks about how we are to run away from sin. And so the closer you're on relationship with Christ, it's not about how much you can get away with. It's actually how much you can get away from sin and see the fruits of righteousness in your life and righteous living. See, if it's about getting close to the line, then we're always going to be playing with fire. But instead, when we talked about repentance, we talked about how we're turning away from that. And turning around is about walking away from the things that you know are going to draw you in to something that's bad. And that can be temptation. That can be something that's different for each person. But 1 Timothy 6:11 says, "But you, O man of God," and you can put woman of God in there if you want, "flee these things." And he actually, before that verse, lists a whole bunch of ungodly things. And he's urging Timothy and saying, "But you, O man of God, flee these things and pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, and gentleness." See, living a life with Christ is about pursuing the right things, not just turning from the wrong things, but pursuing the right things. Because if you're a Christ follower, and if you're close to the heart of Jesus, you're going to be drawn towards the things that please him and that can keep you in that close relationship. So there's two basic views of perseverance that have been discussed forever in Christian circles, and it's the idea of unconditional security, which would be the idea of once saved, always saved, which actually states that it's impossible for a believer ultimately to lose their salvation. This would track along with kind of Reformed theology or Calvinism, and they would teach that you are predestined, and so therefore you can't actually lose your salvation if you're predestined and chosen. But then there's another kind of camp or theme that people talk about, and it's called conditional security, which states that it is possible for a believer to lose their salvation. And this would be more Arminian theology, which is where we would come out of that camp of Arminian theology or conditional security. But all of them actually agree that a believer should persevere in the faith, regardless of what kind of camp you come from or what angle you come from, because we all agree that we should pursue God and press into God. Where the difference is it comes down to a balance between what is the human responsibility, so our perseverance, and the divine sovereignty, which is the security from God. And I actually believe that if we can find a good balance of both in our faith walk, we're going to actually find something very healthy. So I believe that there's human responsibility that is our response to God. That's the perseverance in our faith. That is the outworking of our salvation in Christ. But then there's also the divine sovereignty. God, of course, is above all, and that's the security that he provides. But I believe our lives will be best lived if we find the balance between those two. And we find that balance through this little word called obedience. It's a very important word, but I believe that the sense of assurance that we can have actually comes out of our response in obedience to Christ. 2 Peter 1:10 says, "Therefore, brethren, be even more diligent to make your call and election sure. For if you do these things, you will never stumble." So it talks about an active pursuit of being diligent and being sure to make our call and election sure. And then Philippians 2, verse 12 and 13 says this, "Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you both to will and to do for his good pleasure." In other words, right in that verse, it talks about salvation is ours, but we actually have to continually work it out. It says with fear and trembling, because God is at work in us to will and to do for his good pleasure. Again, remembering that his good pleasure for us is that we live according to his will, that we stay close to his heart. See, sometimes the Holy Spirit will emphasize a certain truth in order for us to find that balance between our human response or responsibility and God's sovereignty. And we have to be careful not to skip over the middle of the road and just land in one side or the other, in one camp or the other, because I believe that our assurance does come from God. I believe firmly that we can have that assurance. But I also believe that our assurance is also confirmed through our response to God. So it's on God, but also on us to respond to him. So what happens then if we don't live in response to God, if we don't live in obedience to him? So when you look at the theology behind unconditional security, it would say that maybe you'll stray for a while, maybe you walk off the path for a while, but you'll always come back because God predestined you. That's a very simplified way to look at it. But the reality is that as we talk about conditional security, where we do have a responsibility in our response, there's also something called backsliding, where we actually walk away from God or walk away from the will of God or from our relationship with him. We actually do see that throughout the Bible. One of the most prevalent places we see that is in the book of Jeremiah during the days of King Josiah. And Josiah, again, was a reforming king. He was a politician. And Jeremiah was the prophet of the day that was out on the streets calling people to return to God and to repent for their backsliding. And you actually see throughout the Old Testament, especially in the book of Judges, you see this cycle of backsliding and then turning and then repenting, coming back to God, and then another cycle of backsliding and then repenting and turning back to God. And so we see this pattern that is a very human pattern. But what it does show us is a couple of things, that God's heart is not for us to walk away, but then when we do, he will always provide means for us to come back to him, because his desire is that we come close to him. So of course, he doesn't want us to walk away. He doesn't want us to backslide. But when we look at what that actually means, backsliding in itself is a fairly Christian term, but it means this. It means a reversible turning away from God. And it's always in the context of turning around. So when backsliding is addressed in the Bible, it's always in the context of you need to come back to God. You have been backslidden. You have walked away from God, but God is calling them to come back. We see that through the prophets in the Old Testament. We see Jesus and John the Baptist preaching this repentance for people to come because they had walked away. And we also see, of course, the most beautiful example of this, I think, in Luke chapter 15 with the story of the prodigal son and how the father just desired for him to come back. See, many, even after coming to Christ, may slip and fall in some area of temptation, but God's desire is that we don't sin, so that he, in order for us to come back to him, he's provided again what we talked about earlier with that advocate that is provided through us, through Jesus, so that we can repent and turn back to God. So you can see that there's like that cycle of when we come, we fall away, there's repentance, and it brings us back to God. But then there's another much more, if I can say, serious level of turning from God. And I do want to mention it because it's not taught on a lot these days. But I want to just mention it so that we are aware that there is a very serious nature to what we need to take into account for our human responsibility and response to God. And it's the term apostasy. Now, apostasy is actually an irreversible turning from God. Hebrews 6, verse 4 to 6 says, "For it is impossible for those who were once enlightened and have tasted the heavenly gift and have become partakers of the Holy Spirit and have tasted the good word of God and the powers of the age to come, if they fall away, to renew them again to repentance, since they crucify again for themselves the Son of God and put him to an open shame." You can also read some other verses if you want about this from Hebrews 10, verse 26, 27, Hebrews 12, verse 15 to 17. Actually, Hebrews is jam-packed with verses that are really good. Read the whole book to get the context. But apostasy is actually a word that refers to falling away from a right standing with God. And the letter A in front of the word is like putting the word un from the English language. So the word literally means no standing. So apostasy, so no posture before God. So reality is that when you talk about these different kind of big topics, it would show that biblically it is possible to lose our salvation, because if it wasn't, this word would have no value, and those key verses that speak directly to it would have no effect. But the reality is that when we talk about this term apostasy, we have to understand it has to do with something very willful, a deliberate choice that someone makes, not just to occasionally slip or be tempted and slip in some sin where they can repent, but we talk about a renunciation of your faith, someone who deliberately renounces their faith. And the very definition actually means the abandonment or renunciation of a religious belief when we look at the word apostasy. So I know that's a big topic, but I think it's important for us to know that God's heart is for everyone to stay close to him. God's heart is for us to constantly run towards him and draw near to him. And his word actually says, if we draw near to him, he will draw near to us. And remember that God is the one, thankfully, that knows man's heart. We don't know another person's heart, but we can only work with our own heart toward Christ. And, you know, if it's possible to actually go too far in walking away from Christ, only God will truly know that. And I always say, while there is still breath in someone, there is still hope for them to turn back. So my faith, my hope is always that no matter how far a person goes, my belief is that God desires for them to come back. So you may ask, where's the line then between backsliding and apostasy? And the reality is that there's no exact clear scriptural line that defines that, but I would want to say that's all in God's hands. So I want to address one more thing before we kind of jump right into how we can live to stay close to the heart of God. But I want to address this particularly kind of difficult topic that a lot of believers at some point in their life have struggled with. And it's from Mark 3, verse 28, 29, what is called in the Bible the unpardonable sin or the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. A lot of believers throughout my life have come to me and said, oh no, what if I've said something against the Holy Spirit? And what if I've committed that unpardonable sin? And I don't want to do anything like that. Well, the fact that you're even worried about that shows me that you actually want to honor the Holy Spirit, that you want to honor Jesus. But if I can give you the definition that Ken Malman, actually a great Bible teacher, gave about this particular thing. He says, it is the ultimate, willful, eternal choice to reject the Holy Spirit's conviction. So it's very willful, and it's a very firm choice that you would make. See, if you reject the Holy Spirit's conviction, then how ultimately could we repent for any other sin? So Jesus is talking about here that resisting the Holy Spirit can be very serious, because that actually would lead us to a place where our hearts become hardened and we won't repent from sin. And if we continually reject the Holy Spirit's conviction and reject the Holy Spirit, period, and don't want him as part of our lives, then oftentimes what we end up with is a hardened heart. But again, I want to say this, because this is where a lot of believers have struggled, that God's heart is for you. And so if your heart is even questioning whether you've said something that have hurt the heart of God or that have bridged into this particular passage, I want to say to you, come to Jesus, come before him, speak to him, and let his love lavish on you. Invite the Holy Spirit in your life. Invite his conviction in your life. Invite his power, his presence, his love to wash over you, because this particular verse has been the one where a lot of people have struggled to find assurance of salvation because they're afraid they've done something wrong. Remember that fear is not of God, fear is of the enemy. The love of Jesus drives out all fear. And so I want to encourage you that Jesus' heart is to draw you close to himself. See, the beauty is that if we continually choose to stay humble and dependent on God, then we're going to be in constant relationship with him. See, what matters most is that we realize that in all these big topics about the assurance of our salvation, about different types of things that could drive us away from God, what we have to see is that there is a balance between God's will, which is for all of us to be in relationship with him, to live a life of love that bears fruits worthy of repentance, to obey him, and to receive his grace to overcome sin. And then there's also our human response in that. Our responsibility is to stay in close relationship with him, because as we do, he will empower us to overcome sin. See, James 4:6 says that he gives more grace, and therefore he says, God resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. See, a heart of humility will keep you in right standing with God. And see, the word for grace here is actually not referring to favor, but it's referring to a divine enablement. So the way to receive his grace for daily living is actually to humble ourselves before the Lord. So I want to end with eight very practical spiritual disciplines that will help us stay in that place of dependence on God and humility for him, and that will help us to work out our salvation like we talked about earlier. And they're simple spiritual disciplines, but it's a simple way to kind of check yourself to see where you're at. The first thing is prayer. Colossians 4:2, talking about how we can put our focus on the one through prayer who has the power to change our life and your circumstance. This is humbling ourselves before God and seeking him in prayer. It talks in the Bible about praying constantly. I don't think that means uttering words all day long, but having a heart that is constantly toward him, constantly praying for him, constantly submitted to him, constantly humble before him. The second spiritual discipline that we can have in our lives is the word of God. Hebrews 4:12 talks about how the word of God is alive and active, sharper than a two-edged sword, and it can actually separate those things that are soulish from those things that are of the spirit. So if we want to talk about assurance, not just of salvation, but of our relationship with him, the best thing you can do is to continually take in the Word of God in your life. See, how did Jesus defeat temptation? By quoting the Word of God. See, the Word is alive and active in you and in me, but we have to take it in and allow it to speak to our hearts and to our minds. The third thing, and some people hate this word, but it's the word fasting. It's an incredible spiritual discipline. We see it in many instances in scripture. One would be in Acts 13, verse 2-3. But it's a spiritual discipline that actually declares that God is more important to you than food itself, that God is your sustenance. And honestly, fasting often helps us in that connection with God. It's like it clears the channel so we can hear from him. It shows him that we put our entire faith, our focus, and our trust in him. Of course, the other thing that I love is worship. John 4, 23, 24, of course, there's tons of places that talk about this, but there's tremendous power in worship. And chapter 4 actually talks about how the Father is seeking people that will worship him in spirit and in truth. And so when we talk about staying close to the heart of God and not straying away from his will or his purpose, then worship is a tremendous weapon, both in private and in corporate settings, because it helps us keep surrendered to Jesus and it reminds us of how great he is and how dependent we need to be on him. The fifth thing that is a spiritual discipline is actually meeting together. I know during COVID, this has looked so different for the first time in any of our life history, but Hebrews 10:25 actually talks about not forsaking or not neglecting meeting together. Obviously, during COVID, things may look a little bit different and not everyone can, but I encourage you, connect online. If you can't be here in person, connect online and be together one way or another with other believers because there is tremendous power in gathering together as believers, even if it has to be online. The sixth thing is giving. 1 Timothy 6, verse 18 and 19 talks about giving because the reality is that we honor God through the discipline of giving. And I'm not just talking finances. Finances is one part of it. But when we truly understand what generosity and giving is all about, we realize that everything belongs to God and we need to be a good steward of what he has given us. And the reality is that if we can't trust God with something as simple as our finances, it's hard to trust him with our lives. So when we talk about giving, we talk about giving to God in every area. And the seventh thing is this word that some people don't like, or two words, I guess. It's talking about submission and accountability. Ephesians 5:21 talks about how there's something very powerful about submitting to one another and recognizing that we need one another. It's actually an incredible spiritual discipline because when you're with other believers, they can help you they can love you and they can help you when they see you stray or walk off. They can be there to love you enough to call you back to a place that honors the Lord. And the last thing is serving. Galatians 5:13 talks about that through love, we can serve one another. See, Jesus didn't come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. So if you want to be great, and if you want to be close to the heart of God, be a servant of all. Remember, we're here to serve God. We're not here to receive recognition per se for that service. We're also not here to use people as rungs on the ladder of our success, but we are to serve people because it's the Jesus type of leadership. And I honestly believe that if we can learn to serve one another, it's the best way to stay close to the heart of Jesus because he came to serve, and that's what he desires for you to do. So as we look at this this concept tonight of staying close to Jesus and having the assurance of our salvation in him, I want you to remember, church, that God's heart for you is to not walk away, but if you sin, remember, there's someone there for you, Jesus Christ. And all you need to do, I call it quick down, quick up. If you fall down, turn to him, come to him, confess, repent, and turn back to him. And he's ready. Just like the father in that prodigal son story is there with open arms, ready to welcome you back. Because what he wants you to do is to live a life of assurance of your standing with him and of your relationship with him because you are a child of God. Thank you for joining us tonight and have a great night.